Okay, everybody, welcome back. Hope everybody could relax a little bit, recharge batteries in the break. And like I said, we will, you know, that session will be a little bit longer since we kind of integrate the project challenge part into it. So we can take a little bit of time to answer some common questions that arose in the chat. Most of it like was pretty much resolved in the chat, but like a few comments, like one question asked, like, you know, how does like metabolic modeling, for instance, compare to things like pie crust, where you kind of also infer metabolic functions by looking at the presence of pathways in genomic data or metagenomic data. And we kind of discussed that in the beginning. So it kind of is like, you know that those enzymes are present, but you don't actually know if the organism will use them, because that depends on the environmental condition. It also depends on, you know, whether it's actually used to produce biomass, for instance. So it can be optional in particular settings. So for instance, if you see that like particular enzymes are present in the organism, they might still have a zero flux. And we actually see that in our, if we look at our flux outputs that we got in the very beginning, when we did our first FBA, we actually observed that there's a whole bunch of metabolic reactions in here that actually get a negative flux assigned, because they would essentially actually lower the effective growth rate of the organism in that environment. And that's kind of a part that, you know, you would not get at with, you know, looking just at genomic data, even when you summarize it on enzymes or metabolic pathways with pie crust or something, because, you know, it won't actually simulate like growth in that particular setting. That's not really a part that's integrated in there. But still, it's really sensitive for other things. So it's great if you just want to get an overview of particular genes that are present and what could possibly be happening in the organism. But here it's like maybe a step further, because we actually, you know, we're doing a simulation of that organism in a particular environment, and we see what's actually funneled into growth rate. So it's a bit more of a detailed view maybe in that particular, you know, what's happening metabolically. So it's really focused on metabolism, but there's things that we can capture. For instance, in pie crust, you might get, you know, for instance, some signaling pathways as well. And that's obviously not included at all in a metabolic model. So it's like, you know, it really depends on what your question is. If you want to study toxicity or signaling, then metabolic models will not help you, because they don't model that at all. But if you're interested in actually, you know, seeing what goes into bacterial growth, then they're really nice for that. Another question is, you know, in some cases when you looked at the metabolic reaction, they actually didn't really see like a GMP protein reaction rule. And that's because we all have different, you know, assemblies and different metabolic reactions included in our metabolic model. In some cases, the 40-second reaction might be like a transport reaction. A lot of transport reactions don't often have a gene protein reaction rule. One, because a lot of transporters are not well characterized, but like as commented in this lecture as well, sometimes we have additional evidence that this particular transporter is needed. So for instance, for our growth media, if CAFME detects that there's a compound in the growth media and you have the full pathway within the cell to break down that compound that is required for biomass, it might actually add in a transport reaction, even if that transport reaction has no genomic evidence. Just to be able to fulfill that particular pathway and like obtain biomass from it. It can also be happening, some transport reactions don't really actually need a gene, right? So for instance, the transport reaction for hydrogen or water, that kind of diffuses into the cell kind of just passively. So there's no actual protein that kind of facilitates that, or it doesn't have to be at least. So this doesn't actually have an enzyme or protein assigned to it. And those are still present in the model, because we all know that cells usually are capable of, you know, absorbing water from the environment. So that's another thing where we would not have a gene protein reaction rule. So if you kind of want to maybe see an example of one, and because you didn't see it for your model, you can also kind of use, like, instead of using your 40-second reactions, you can also do reactions dot and then add in the identifier, as long as it doesn't have spaces in it. One thing that's probably present in all of the models is phosphofructokinase. So you could, for instance, say dot reactions dot PFK, and that will give you, you know, that's a really well annotated reaction. So you will definitely see the fairly complex gene protein reaction rule here. And also that will have probably a bit more annotation. So that's one way to have that. Yep, that's kind of, I think, like two of the questions that maybe warrant a bit more discussion. And yeah, like, don't be surprised if some of the outputs look a little bit different. Like I said, you're the first one right now that's looking at the particular assembly you're looking at. We did some checks that, you know, nothing completely horrible happens there, but obviously your results will be different, right? Your reconstruction might have more or less reactions included. It might behave a little bit different, give you a different growth rate, but that's actually super interesting and something we want to look at in that second part of the course a little bit more, actually. So let's maybe get into that. And let's maybe, you know, address one particular problem here, which is also that, you know, how do we actually identify if our flux distribution is unique for producing biomass? So that's like another part. But one thing that's like super interesting is looking at what we got from our model summary, like there's a lot of information we suddenly generated, right? All of our models were simulated on exactly, you know, well, actually we don't know what they got simulated on, but we kind of see that, you know, we get like a lot of prediction of particular carbon molecules here. We actually characterize something about the uptake. So we learned something about the interaction between our organism and the environment, because all of that are basically uptakes from the environment, and they happen in really specific ratios here to enable the maximum biomass formation. That particular for distribution of percentages and the carbon influx here, that's not something we put into the modeling. That's like an output that we actually got after we ran the simulation, the flux balance analysis part. So it's kind of like a result that's not really obvious if you look at the genome, right? Would you have gotten the same data distribution of carbon fluxes if you looked just at the genome? Probably not. You actually needed to build that model. So like, yeah, it's like an emerging property of the system. So it's something that wasn't really obvious beforehand and that we got out. And it's like actually really interesting because it tells us something about how that organism interacts with the environment. And that actually suddenly jumps into ecology. So that's like something we will look at a little bit in the second part of the course. But before that, let's, you know, let's make sure that what we get as a result in flux distribution also makes sense. And the first thing we might want to look at is to go back to that initial problem of non-uniqueness. So let's switch to the slides here for a second. So like I said, getting an optimal growth rate out of your model does not mean that you get unique fluxes. So if you remember in the initial part of the presentation, we kind of had that, you know, observation that, you know, flux balance analysis is kind of selecting a subspace of the entire flux cone that's kind of, you know, consistent with biological assumptions. But in our case, that doesn't necessarily reduce to a single point in the flux space. There might be different distributions of flux solutions that have different values. One example, for instance, is shown here. So you could imagine you have that metabolic network, it's producing biomass, but there's actually different flux distributions that all produce biomass and actually exactly the same optimal value. That's not really uncommon that happens. You might have alternative pathways. You might have pathways that actually don't contribute to biomass at all. So they could be shut off or shut on. And here's like an example. So you could have an FBA and they kind of give the same solution. Like one gives us, both have a maximum growth of 0.87, for instance. In one case, I can use, you know, 7 enzymes and 3 transporters to get this biomass. In another case, I might actually use less enzymes and 1 transporter. And it kind of, you know, corresponds to, you know, going in the shaded red area and the flux cone here, like there's alternative solutions and some might be better than others. And so how can we maybe like, you know, get a unique solution here? So something we can actually compare. And one idea is to actually add in additional constraints to the model or principles to the model that kind of are consistent with biology. And one idea that has, you know, worked really well in practice is called parsimonious FBA, which kind of takes the idea or takes the stance that, you know, producing enzymes is a costly process. So if I want to express like way more enzymes than I need to, that has a cost. Like I need to produce, you know, I need to sacrifice those amino acids that might not be available to produce biomass or components that I actually need for growth. So it's not necessarily like the case that I can just use any enzyme in the cell and that will be basically like, you know, free of any consequences. So it's kind of, you know, maybe reasonable to assume that bacteria will not like to produce more enzymes than actually necessary. So how do we actually translate that into fluxes? Well, if a flux in a metabolic reaction is zero, it means, you know, there is no conversion going on. So I don't need an enzyme. I don't need to catalyze a reaction that shut off, right? So the idea is basically, well, can I find a flux distribution where, you know, I use the minimum amount of actual metabolic reactions to achieve the maximum biomass? So it's kind of like, you know, the enzymatically speaking, it's the cheapest way to obtain the maximum biomass for a cell. And that has been shown under experimental conditions to actually reproduce experimental fluxes in E. coli, for instance, very well. So if you actually compare the flux distribution you get with this parsimonious solution, that actually corresponds to measured fluxes in E. coli in like a bioreactor. And the way you integrate that is by basically creating an additional constraint first in the model where you say, okay, I still want to maintain the maximum biomass rate. So I first run a normal FBA, I get an estimation for the maximum growth rate, and now I fixate that in the model. I say, okay, the biomass reaction has to always fulfill that growth rate, which is kind of similar or equivalent of you're only looking for possible solution in that shaded area in the flux space. And now I have that additional minimization here, and it kind of tells you use the sum of absolute values of the flux. That looks maybe a bit funky. Maybe if you're really into machine learning, you might have seen that. That's called an L1 regularization. It's a particular term that essentially will try to obtain a particular objective by, you know, choosing most of the parameters to be zero and just only setting a few to non-zero values. So that is like equivalent of, you know, choosing fluxes where the majority of fluxes, if it's possible, are zero and like some are only shut on. In practice, actually, a lot of those fluxes actually have to be active to produce biomass. So you can't shut off the majority of pathways in the cell, but you will see some of them being shut off. And that's called the parsimonious solution. And it often, you know, allows us to reduce that particular space here into like a smaller solution space. In many cases, it actually, you know, ends up with a unique solution where you have now a really fixated flux distribution. And that's also really easy to run. So we can go back to our notebook and maybe start and just compare that with parsimonious FBA. Okay, let's do that. That's like the next cell here. It's a bit further down in comparative reverse ecology, which we will get into a little bit more. And instead of actually running model.aptimize, we actually now run a function called PFBA that runs parsimonious FBA. So we can do it. It behaves exactly the same as the previous FBA solution. So we just, you know, save it as a PFBA solution and then again make a model subsummary. And it looks probably fairly similar. You can definitely check that your growth rate will be exactly the same because that's the condition of parsimonious FBA. You still have to maintain close to the optimal growth rate. And you could compare, for instance, see, did it actually change your import fluxes? In my case, it still looks to use mostly CelloBios and also G3PG. It doesn't actually change it. And in many cases, it might not actually change the import fluxes as much. It's actually good. It tells us, you know, even though we weren't sure that our like uptake rates were particularly unique in the beginning, we now know that they are pretty fixated. So there isn't really that much flexibility in those uptake preferences. You might actually see some changes in the secretion. You might actually see less molecules secreted now because you might have maybe some optional pathways that weren't required for biomass. And it's unlikely that a cell would actually, you know, optimize to secrete certain components if it doesn't really help in, you know, in fitness, even though there are certain conditions that might be helpful. And we will talk about that a little bit. Awesome. So yeah, we now got a unique flux solution. Looks like everything is peachy. Well, maybe let's do one little thing. So we got our first results, but are they realistic, right? So do you remember that I said that the biomass flux is essentially equivalent to the growth rate? Like, you know, if you have ever looked at growth rates in a lab setting, you don't actually see growth rates like 100 per hour that often. And why is that? Well, growth rate is a bit like an abstract concept. There's actually a formula to convert a growth rate to a doubling time. A doubling time is a bit more intuitive, right? It's the time that you actually take before you double a bacterium. So, because before you double your biomass, so it's kind of the time that you take for a cell division, so to speak. And that actually, we might have some intuition, right? If you have grown maybe bacteria in the lab, you know, it takes a while to actually get to a high OD and you can get like the doubling time and approximate it. So let's calculate it for our example. So we use the objective value from the FBA solution, which is the growth rate. It actually shows it if you hover over it. And you can calculate that doubling time, and we will also, you do some formatting to convert it to seconds as well, you know. And in our case, it tells me it's 0.03 hours. So my organism is predicted to duplicate every 25 seconds, which is, you know, very fast. Well, unreasonably fast, we could say, right? So nobody, I think, actually complains that the growth rate was too high in the Slack chat. Maybe you have too much confidence in me. So that's really nice. But like also sometimes good to be critical. So if you maybe thought to yourself, well, that growth rate seems too high, that's a bit odd. Well, then you should, you know, pat yourself on the back or find a mirror and tell yourself that you're really smart cookie because, you know, you were absolutely right. Like no actual bacterium will probably duplicate every 25 seconds. If that would happen in the human gut, you would all blow up, right? Like just imagine that case, like you eat some food and imagine like every 25 seconds, all the bacterial biomass in your gut duplicates. Well, just that after a few hours would not look good for you. So it's unlikely to happen, right? And what is actually the reason for that? Let's investigate. So like we didn't actually talk about constraints that much. So we were pretty laissez-faire about that. So initially, you know, we kind of stated, for internal reactions, we use that flux bound of 1,000. Maybe that's close to the diffusion limit. Maybe it's not, it's just very large, no? And we actually didn't look at all about, you know, the exchange fluxes, which kind of limit what can come into the cell. In our case, if you actually look at CAFMI by default, opens all possible exchanges with a really high rate. Let's, for instance, look at the first exchange reaction we have. It's some odd component. It's probably not present even, you know, maybe it is present. It's propane 1,2-diol, but not something we would maybe expect in a normal diet. And if you look at the lower bound, like you see that by default, it's an export. So it goes out of the cell. It's an import where you kind of, well, it's an export. Sorry, I get confused by that as well. It's always like hard to judge, but yeah. It is a component and one reaction of the cell, it's present. And then on the other side of the reactions, it's not present. So that means it actually disappears, which would be like an export out of the extracellular space of the cell. So it disappears. And the inverse would be an import. So it's coming from nothing and it's coming in. And that bound is set to -1,000. So that means like 1,000 millimoles per gram dry weight per hour. We can convert the 1,000 millimole. That's, you know, 1 mole per gram dry weight of cells. So that would be about 6 × 10^23 molecules per hour per 1 gram of cell. So that's like that's a massive amount here, right? So that's like a million molecules per hour, more or less, per 1 gram of bacteria per, that's way too much. It's probably unlikely that they take up that much, right? So, but we gap filled the model with realistic media, but we didn't actually use them for the model, right? We just read the model from CAFMI. Maybe we confided would adjust or use our particular media, but it didn't. So let's do that extra step and actually use a realistic medium. In our case, let's maybe use the medium that we used for CAFMI as well, because it already had those flux bounds there. Like if you remember, that's what we do here. We actually read in the CAFMI media. We format it a little bit like, you know, by setting an index. So we actually have like something we can index by. And we also filter it and we will only use like maybe the gut diet from, you know, average European diet that we derived. And we have the flux bounds here. We have all those reactions. So let's actually apply it to the model. Let's actually say, oh, well, the import constraints are based on that particular condition. So like you cannot import more than, you know, was approximated that you consume per hour in average over a day. And there's some extra steps here. The flux again is given in millimole per gram dry weight per hour. And if you look at those values, they are much smaller than 1,000. Like it's definitely not as many molecules. We see that some of them are really tiny and that kind of makes sense. Things like pectin, for instance, it's a very carbon-rich molecule. It will not be present in huge concentrations. So it can still produce a lot of glucose because pectin, you know, can be broken down into like a lot of glucose molecules, for instance. So we kind of do that. We do one extra step here where we actually filter So even those components are present in the medium, we might not have them present in our model. Maybe there was no transport reaction identified, or CAFMI didn't judge it as significant to include it. So, you know, not all of them might be found in our model. That's fine. Like a bacterium might not necessarily have to eat every single component that's present in your diet. They might only eat a subset. But like, we do that extra little bit of code here that basically, you know, we get all the exchange IDs from the model, and then we check which of them are actually present, you know, in the model and in the diet. And we only apply those found fluxes to our model as constraints. And that's set with like just the model.medium, and then you assign those flux bounds, which are named by the reaction name. That now limits it, like it adjusts the constraints in our model to be actually consistent with those uptake, maximum uptake rates that we estimate based on that particular diet. And we can actually repeat our analysis, like just run the PFPA, and we will see there will be a massive change of the result. It will not look at all like the one we had before. So first of all, the growth rate is much smaller. Like instead of 100 in my case, it's now 0.03. So that's like already a big change. But also if I look at the major carbon source, it's, you know, I actually still have cellobios in there. So that seems to be something pretty hard-coded in my organism, but I actually see a lot of other carbon sources that weren't there. So it definitely changed the results pretty massively. Could look more, for instance, I see trehalose suddenly as a major carbon source. Trehalose is like a compound. It's like kind of a sugar that's kind of found in a lot of plants. So that's something you do actually consume, and it's actually not taken up in the small intestine. So that's something you would actually expect to find in the gut. And also my secretion looks very different. I now secrete much more carbon dioxide, for instance, and like some other molecules as well. But like that profile looks completely different. And we can also recalculate the doubling time based on that new growth rate. And now I get a doubling time of 20 hours, which is very different. That is, you know, likely to work out much better in the human gut. So a bit more realistic. So that's like something you should be aware of. Like, you know, even though those particular things are kind of hard to formulate, those growth media, because they can't, you know, they're not really concentrations. So they import fluxes. So you kind of have to, you know, get some information. But still, those environmental conditions are critical for realistic results. And that's something why we use metabolic modeling, because they actually allow us to integrate that environmental information into what we're doing. And in general, I would say, you know, like what we saw in the first step is what is called an unconstrained model. Well, actually there were constraints, but they were unreasonably high. So basically it could import everything that it has possibly in transporter for, but in any real environment, you will never find, you know, all the molecules that you can possibly take up given, you know, from the model reconstruction. Then qualitative data is already much better. So if you might not have the perfect import fluxes, but you kind of, you know, have a list of components that are present in the environment. So that could be from an experimental growth media, even if you kind of use like kind of arbitrary flux bounds for those, like fairly small ones, like 1 millimole for gram dry weight or something, that will already give you much better results and agreement. And then the best thing you can get is quantitative results. Either you actually measured the import fluxes for the particular component, you can do that, for instance, you know, by growing the cell and then doing metabolomics on the growth media over time. Then you will basically see that certain metabolites like lower their concentrations as they get taken up by the cells. If you count the cells, you can get an approximation how fast that happens, and you can put that into the bounds for the uptake rates. You can do more back of the envelope calculations. That's all usually tends to work out a little bit better, because at least if you have some notion that the uptake rate for certain carbon molecules will be much higher simply because there's much more in the surrounding, that will already change the results. So it's like kind of important to use that. Okay. And it gave us like much more realistic results just by applying that, even though that, you know, that particular diet inference, and we estimated the fluxes. We jumped over that a little bit because we ran out of time. Now, like, let's go a little bit into the reverse ecology argument. So like I said, if we actually look at it, what did we get from it? Well, we now like, we took a realistic environment, we had our model, and we actually learned what this particular organism consumes from the environment. And what you already saw is that probably your organism didn't actually consume the same carbon molecules that mine did, right? So it might actually not have eaten cellobios at all. It might have imported something else, secreted other molecules, even though it was simulated on the same environment. So we learned something about, you know, that particular isolate or that bacterium and the interaction with their physical environment, and that is ecology. Like really, the interaction of, you know, living organisms with the environment and other organisms, that's kind of what ecology is all about. So, but did we actually use ecology data? Well, ecological data would be observing those things in the environment, and we didn't do that. We didn't look at any, you know, experimental data of our bacterium in that particular growth medium. Nobody has probably built a growth medium on that particular, you know, diet composition that we use. Like, that's not something you use in the lab. We didn't put the organisms there and measure growth curves. So we didn't really do those basic steps like of ecology, of actually observing, you know, the interaction between the organism and its environment or other organisms. We did something which is called reverse ecology. So it's a study of an organism's genome as a means to estimate its ecological niche or to, you know, estimate ecological behavior as well. So one way to see that is, you know, just reformulating what we did. Like, you know, what we said is, okay, we simulated the strains with FBA under the same environmental conditions. They all showed different uptake rates for different sets of metabolites to obtain their maximum growth rate. That's kind of, you know, really lingo that we would use in systems biology and flux balance analysis. But an ecologist might say, well, we estimated the realized niche of bacterial strains grown in isolation under an optimal fitness objective. Very different language, but they kind of realized they refer to similar concepts. For instance, optimal fitness. Well, fitness is a few things in ecology, but, you know, growth rate is often really used as a proxy for fitness. Like, you would think that an organism that can grow really fast is evolutionary speaking quite fit. Like, it can, you know, compete with other organisms quite well. And also uptake rates. Well, that's kind of, you know, the set of molecules that I take up from the environment and that enable me to actually grow, well, that's really close to a growth niche, right? It's the actual niche that the particular bacterium uses. Though that's often called the realized niche. Like, it's not really just the habitat, it's actually what I take up from the habitat to form biomass. So we can actually gather some more concepts from that as well. For instance, you know, ecology is also about interactions between different species or strains. So what would it mean ecologically for two strains to inhibit a very similar metabolic niche or very different ones? Like, what does it mean, for instance, if my bacterium and your bacterium take up exactly the same metabolites? What would happen if they both exist in, you know, in our gut at the same time? What would happen if they take up extremely different molecules? There almost no overlap. So think about that a little bit. Think about that the human gut is, you know, also in some way nutrient limited. Like, actually, a lot of our nutrients get absorbed in the small intestine. Not everything makes it to the gut. So what would happen if, you know, a lot of bacteria ate very similar things? So what would happen if they don't? So, and yeah, let's get into that a little bit more. Let's do some reverse ecology. Okay. The first thing we will do is, like, you know, we will try to reduce that a little bit. So we have those cool uptake rates. Let's actually, you know, format that a little bit. So one thing what we will do is we will, you know, filter our fluxes to only have the uptake rates. It's kind of the same information shown in the summary, but here's like the code that you would actually use to do that. So we can get the fluxes from our solution. We will actually filter them. So we only consider fluxes where we actually have an import, which is, you know, means that we actually take something up from the environment. We also take fluxes, only those fluxes that are exchanges. So that gives us only the uptake rates. So it kind of looks like this, it's just a filter. And we take, like, the dot hat will only show the first few of those. It's actually much more. If you remove that, you would see all of them. It just becomes like pretty long in the output. So, okay. That's our uptake rates. So now the sign isn't really that important anymore. Since I only have uptake rates, I could also just say, okay, I formulate them as, you know, a positive flux. I just say that's in the direction of the uptake. And we can also kind of, you know, get in some more information, like annotated. So for instance, that particular code here, what it does is it goes kind of through it and annotates it each with the reaction name with the metabolite. And then we do that like funky list comprehension here in Python, which the only thing it actually does is it goes through each metabolite and actually gets the actual name of the metabolite. So, you know, it makes a bit more sense and adds that in as well. And we get that nice data frame here. Again, we only show the first few, and it shows us, for instance, you know, the uptake rate, it shows us the reaction, but it also, you know, gives us the actual metabolite. So now I can actually see, ah, okay, my organism takes up alanine with that flux and glycerol with that flux. Okay, and one thing we might want to do now is a really interesting part is to, you know, all come together, like everybody that participated today, share their results and compare them between each other and kind of get to some comparative reverse ecology by actually taking, you know, is there differences between it? What happens if my bacterium and your bacterium are from the same species? Do they absorb different things? What happens if they're from the same genus? Like those are things we might want to look at. So that's super easy. You know, we have that magical function that actually gives you the exchanges from everybody in the course and then some. So it gives you exchanges from everybody across the globe, even people that, you know, we might not see on Zoom right now. So we actually get a huge set of them. In our case, we get it for all 980 of those assemblies. And, you know, we get a really big table. It gives us, you know, the assembly we are actually looking at. For each assembly, you have one row for each uptake, basically. So there's different reactions for a single assembly, the uptake fluxes and also the secretion fluxes. So all the positive ones would be secretion fluxes, the negative would be uptake fluxes. We actually also have an annotation of the species now for the assembly. That's the information you saw in the very beginning. We have the full classification of the taxonomy and also the genus. So that's kind of the summary. It's a pretty big, you know, information base we get here. So we have like total information for more than 75,000 individual metabolite reactions for each in different assemblies. So it's, you know, quite a big database. We can kind of filter out again only the uptake fluxes. So if we do that, you know, we know it's kind of filtered. And we also, like I said, we kind of dropped the sign from it. It's not super important. You know, we know those are all uptake reactions. They always go in an import direction to the cell. Okay. So now, well, let's maybe visualize it. Let's take a look, right? And one thing we could do is, you know, try to visualize that uptake matrix in a certain way. So we use a function again from Seambolt called cluster map. We actually saw that yesterday already. We used that to take a quick look at the abundances of genera across different environments. We will use it again. And what we will do is first we convert that data set to an actual matrix. So we kind of, you know, use a pivot table function that's kind of included in pandas and will be used here. One thing is also we should consider maybe is that, well, so the uptake rate will differ quite a lot, right? You will see that, you know, large molecules like pectin or cellobios, they will never be taken up at really high rates. Those are massive molecules. They cannot be imported quickly into a cell. But things like water, that just, you know, it flows in as massive fluxes. And we kind of want to, you know, get like a better grip of that. Otherwise, it would dominate our visualization. We would see huge fluxes for your water and really small fluxes for everything else. So what we can do is there's several strategies. We could, for instance, normalize by molecular mass. That might work. We can also just log transform it, like, you know, getting like the order of magnitude of everything. Log transformation kind of smooths out those differences between really large and really small values. So that's like another way to do it. For that to happen though, they cannot be negative. So when we build up the matrix, we'll actually add in the really small flux that is, you know, corresponds to something that doesn't have any flux, 10 to the minus 6, that's probably like less than a few molecules. So and we will convert it into a matrix. You know, the rows are metabolites. The columns are the particular assembly. The values are the flux, which is kind of the import or uptake rate. And then we visualize that into the matrix. Like I said, we log transform the entire uptake matrix. We use like a particular color scale. And, you know, since we have a lot of assemblies, we kind of won't really show the values for it, but then we will show it for the particular metabolites for sure. And then we make the figure a little bit bigger. And if we run that, you know, it might take a little bit to kind of build up the entire visualization, but it looks like this. So we have like a quite massive thing. which kind of shows us now for each single assembly or for each single bacterium, which we had an assembly for, that's kind of the individual columns of that plot. And each single metabolite, the color kind of shows how much, you know, how fast it is taking up. If it's not taking up, it's essentially like black. And then we have values like going to lighter colors, the faster something is taking up. And that's kind of on a logarithmic scale. We also have those dendrograms again that group together either assemblies that assembly models that kind of take up very similar sets of molecules at the same rates, and also molecules that get taken up in really similar patterns. And we see, you know, that doesn't look like there is like, you know, just a single particular uptake profile. So you see that, like, you know, certain set of assemblies will take up fairly different molecules. For instance, like the ones here on the top get taken up only by the assembly, like on the lower left, kind of on this plot. We have a few metabolites that seem to be taken up by almost all of the assemblies, you know, things like very, you need iron, for instance, for the mitochondria. That's like, you know, essential to actually run, you know, the energy pathways. But then you have certain things that are really spotty, you know, silent, like longer silent structures only get important, for instance, by a few bacteria in the entire data set and not by any other. You have a few molecules that get taken up by only really small set. So there's definitely preferences here, like uptake preferences that seem to be fairly different across different organisms. The one thing we could ask is, how is that actually related to phylogeny? Do organisms that have very similar genomes also have very similar uptake preferences, right? And that is kind of encapsulated in a concept that is called phylogenetic niche conservatism. So that kind of means things that are phylogenetically very close should also kind of occupy similar growth niches. So they should prefer similar things. And that's important because if, you know, phylogenetic niche conservatism is true, that means we can actually learn something, you know, when we extrapolate from like close organisms to, if you see a new organism is really close to a particular, particular species that we already have sequenced, we could assume that it behaves similar in a particular environment, but we don't know that, right? So let's kind of check for that. So to do that, like one initial thing we could do is we could try, okay, let's look at a single species in that particular uptake plot, right? If the phylogenetic niche conservatism is very strong, you would assume that within a single species, there's zero variation in the uptake rates. They should take up exactly the same molecules. So we would pick one species that we had a lot of individual assemblies for. We use Foucault-Cola vulgatus, and that's like, you might know that that was the recent renaming of Bacteroides vulgatus. That's a fairly common bacterium in the human gut. It's fairly easy to isolate. It was recently renamed, but we have quite a few assemblies here in the data set. So let's look at only that. And we do kind of also kind of want to have, you know, yeah, we want to check if that, you know, has some variation in the preferred uptake rates to maximize its biomass. To actually filter by that, we first have to actually identify the assemblies belonging to that particular species. So we kind of assemble like an isolate metatail, which has the annotation for each isolate. So basically it just contains a list of each assembly together with the genus, species, and the full taxonomic classification. And we can generate that from our abundance table, basically by only taking those columns and dropping duplicates, because we have, you know, for each assembly, we have several uptake rates. We don't want that information duplicated if we're just looking at the genus and species assignments. Do some reordering and basically end up with like a list of those values. And then we filter the uptake matrix by only using those isolate species that are actually belonging to Foucault-Cola vulgatus. And then we can generate the same map. Let's maybe rotate it this time. So this time we have the assemblies kind of in the columns, and we have in the rows, and we have the metabolites in the columns, just because we have less assemblies here. It's still quite a few. If you look at that, so, well, it's kind of, you know, we kind of have phylogenetic niche conservatism. So we do see that there's a large swath of metabolites here that get taken up by all strains in that species. But there's also a few that are really specific, right? Guanine, for instance, here gets taken up by maybe a fourth of all of the assemblies, but not by the others. So even though all of those assemblies come from exactly the same species, there's definitely some variation in their uptake rate preference. And that can be because those strains came from different environments. It can mean that we have metabolic functions that are actually, you know, in the accessory genome of that. So they're less conserved than other regions. Hard to say, but we definitely see that, you know, it's, even though we see some more correspondence, so that, you know, we have a really long list, maybe half of the things that are actually consumed by those strains are definitely shared across all strains of that species. There are things that are not shared. So there's definitely information here. So how does it look for everything, right? How does it look for every single assembly? Well, it becomes hard. We could kind of do that for every single species. We get a lot of those individual maps. We could also, if we only want to see if things are similar or not, we could also kind of try to reduce it and make a new visualization that maybe doesn't show as much information, but is maybe, you know, more informative for the particular questions that we have. So what could we use? Well, we will actually look at something called niche maps. We will drop some information. We will essentially drop the information of which metabolite, like individual metabolites in the uptake rates. We will only kind of do it on a basis of distances. So we will basically want a visualization where strains that, you know, take up similar sets of molecules at the same rates are really close to each other, and strains that take up molecules, very different molecules, are far away from each other. And we will actually use that in a kind of a map, because, you know, if you want to, for instance, know which are the grocery stores nearest, closest to you, you don't look at like a heat map of, you know, grocery stores to your home distances or anything like that. You open up a map, no, and you just look which ones are close and which ones are far away. That's kind of how you want to consume it as a human. So we want to do something similar. So we want to build a map. It has like X and Y coordinates. And in each of those coordinates, like, we draw a single point for an assembly, and if they are close, then they take up similar things. It's not based on the genome, it's only based on the metabolic uptake rates to produce biomass. We use an algorithm for that, which is called UMAP. Well, seems like it's a good algorithm because it has map in the name, right? And we want to build a map, kind of makes sense. And it's kind of similar to things we have looked at yesterday a little bit. So it's easy to calculate distances between uptake rates. We log transformed them. They're kind of, you know, just values. We could, for instance, use Euclidean distances to see if one profile is closer to another. Then we want to arrange them on a 2D map in a most consistent way with those distances. There's a lot of methods. We have looked at principal coordinate analysis, which is a linear method. UMAP is a non-linear method. Supposedly, it will give you the best representation of those points in 2D that is consistent with the distance matrix that you have. So that sounds good. Like, you know, it's the best map that we can build that is kind of based on the distances of each of the uptake preferences. So let's build that. We use the UMAP package. We import it. UMAP has parameters that you can use to kind of change the output a little bit and tune it. The only thing we will adjust is the minimum distance between points in the final map, just because we know that, you know, some of the assemblies will have very similar uptake rates. So they will be basically piled on top of each other on the map, and the minimum distance, you know, just disperses them a little bit more. Again, we use that based on the logarithmic transformed uptake matrix. And we get basically two coordinates, UMAP one, UMAP two. That's like the X and Y coordinates out of it. And we put that into a nice data frame. So if we do that, it will take a little bit because, you know, it's quite a lot of points here. Like, that matrix is fairly large, as we have seen, but it shouldn't take forever. UMAP is, you know, fairly fast. You could also use other projections. You know, T-SNE would work. You could also use the principal coordinate analysis. You could also think about other distance matrices. There's a lot of liberty here. But for now, we just want, like, you know, good representation. You might see a warning here. You can ignore that. You know, it shows us that some versions might not be compatible, but they turn out to actually be compatible. And it gives us something like that. So now every assembly has, you know, a one X and a Y coordinate. So that's pretty close to, you know, GPS coordinates on a map, for instance. So that's something we can show in the map. We kind of maybe want to add in back our information about, you know, what's the species of that assembly, what's the genus, to kind of get like some nice interpretation of the results. We can do that. And we get something like this. So now we have that assembly. The first one is Alice Stipes on the donkey, for instance, and we have an X and Y coordinate. So now we can actually plot it, and we can even color it by, for instance, a genus and species and get like a nice visualization. So let's do that. So we use matplotlib for that and seaborn, like as a mixture. We only use matplotlib to make the figure a bit larger. You know, a map should be large so we can actually judge what's going on. The genus in this case is already assigned. If you wanted to, you know, get it from the species, you could get it again. And then we will plot like just in an X and Y coordinate system colored by the particular genus, for instance, and we get something like that. So now what we kind of see here is that those clusters, which are far away from each other, they consume very different sets of metabolites. If something is very close to each other, for instance, in this cluster here, everything consumes very similar metabolites to produce biomass. And what we see is, like, for some reason, those patches seem to have similar colors, right? Like each patch is kind of colored similarly, except for like a set here in the beginning. So that means that things within a genus seem to be pretty close to each other, but between different genera, they kind of are a bit different. And we can kind of ask the same question again, and maybe even look at species from and assemblies from a single genus. So for instance, if we look at the Bacteroides genus, which is a very abundant genus in the human gut, we can create a map just for that, like kind of like zooming in a subpart of this map that only pertains to Bacteroides. In this case, those would be somewhere here in the middle of it. And what we see here is like kind of an interesting structure with like, you know, there's a few assemblies that kind of separate from the bulk. We also see, you know, some of those species seem to be pretty much within each other. Like we see Bacteroides cerevisiae, for instance, a pretty own out group. Also Theta Iota micron here is pretty separated, but we also have like a few Bacteroides that kind of are really close to each other. So they consume very similar sets of metabolites. So their niches are kind of overlapping. They're kind of very similar to each other. And that's kind of like a bunch of them. So you can ask, oh, okay, well, what does that mean, right? So first we see they do not separate strictly by species. We have that cluster here that actually comprises several species. So there's some information here that's, you know, not really captured only in the genomic identity, which is kind of, you know, what a species means. Also, we could make some predictions about coexistence, right? So maybe you want to discuss that in the chat a little bit, and we can come back to that in a few seconds. But you know, what does it mean? Like Theta Iota micron here is very separated from the rest of those Bacteroides. Like if this particular species would have to cohabitate in the gut, for instance, with Bacteroides fragilis, which I think is over here, do you think that would be possible? They use very different growth niches. What happens if, for instance, you know, some of those that are really close want to inhabits the gut, Bacteroides fragilis or Bacteroides uniformis, would you, you know, those have very similar growth niches. So what's the, like your prediction of that? If you think about, you know, how that would behave, and maybe like as a hint, you know, what happens if you and your friends all want the last chocolate chip cookie, which is basically you all have the same growth niche, right? You also want to grow on chocolate chip cookies. So what would happen there? Maybe, yeah, the TAs can let me know if there's some replies in the chat. Yep, some time here going on. And you can basically use that to also look at other genera and species. So in your case, you might want to look at the genus of the assembly that you actually, you know, looked at. In some case, it might be that you've got the only assembly in the data set for the particular genus. And in that case, that map will be a single point. It might not be really informative. But, you know, maybe you already see some else. You will actually see that depending on the genus, those maps look very different. Bacteroides, for instance, has that structure where you see those subclusters. If you look at some other genera, you will see that essentially it all collapses into a single cluster. Like every single assembly from that genus will basically use the same metabolites for growth. So that is definitely specific to particular, you know, clades, which can be informative as well in when thinking about how those systems assemble. Yeah, awesome. Really good. That's some great ecological thinking. So basically, yeah, some message is said that essentially if you have very similar growth niches and you co-inhabit in the gut, you would compete for the same resources, right? And that might be actually something that doesn't really happen that often, because, you know, in ecology, we have that concept of the niche exclusion principle, or basically stating that if, you know, two organisms have exactly the same growth niche, usually one of them wins because one of them is a little bit more efficient than the other. And so over time, it will displace the one that is less efficient. So either the other organism will be, you know, go extinct, or it has to, you know, evolve a way to use a little bit of a different growth niche. And what we see here is there seem to be some of those patterns. Like, you know, we see some separation of some of those bacteroides species to actually occupy a very unique growth niche that doesn't actually compete anymore with even with species in the same genus. And in some cases, you might even see that on strain levels. So a certain strain might, you know, actually take up, like have such a diverged growth niche that it doesn't suddenly, you know, compete with other assemblies or other strains from the same species anymore. And that's often called niche partitioning. It's basically a mechanism, like how you can make sure that you can coexist with genomically or genetically very similar organisms in the environment. You basically, you know, try to find a growth niche that is made a bit more isolated and allows it to grow. There's a major drawback here that we need to consider, and that, well, what could it be? There's one thing. First of all, even though we now infer kind of, you know, competition from it, we only simulated a single of those bacteria in a single environment. And I alluded to that in the beginning a little bit. It doesn't have to be that unique. Like bacteria are, you know, they're really, really great in surviving. They're really awesome in trying to survive in different environments. And a single strain or species usually can take up different growth niches depending on the environment, but even in the same environment. So you could, for instance, also imagine that, you know, in the gut microbiome, we have all those different species and strains interacting. A lot of them actually also produce and secrete metabolites that might be consumed by other bacteria in the gut microbiome. Not every metabolite that a bacterium in the gut microbiome eats has to come from the diet. It can also be produced by other bacteria in the system. And that, you know, we didn't really put that into our growth medium, right? There's no compounds that are exclusively produced by bacteria. There's also compounds that get produced by the host, like for instance, mucin is pretty abundant in the large intestine and can be broken down by bacteria. Primary bile acids, you know, that get created in the bile duct and get secreted in the intestinal system is also pretty much present, and we didn't really consider that. So our formulation of the environmental condition wasn't 100%. We also ignored that there might actually be metabolic interactions between different strains here, and that can actually separate that niche space more. So sometimes you could see that, for instance, a single strain maybe can take up, you know, different growth niches, and depending who else is around, it might switch to another one because it gives us a growth advantage because it can get out of a competition with a different strain. And if you are interested in that, you might want to look at the videos from last year's course where we actually looked at a metabolic modeling platform that combines different models and kind of simulates like a full microbiome and all the interactions that are going on. And we definitely saw that there was some metabolic interactions that can drive that niche space to a different level. But yeah, it's kind of a good approximation here. So there's limitations to it, and we should be aware of that. Most of it, we don't actually get those higher order interactions in those simulations. Our environmental conditions are probably not 100%. So that's something we should think about. But still, we got quite a lot of insight from that. You know, from something that was just nucleotides, we got into those niche maps. We predicted whether there would be competition between different strains or species. There's a lot of insight we can generate from that. And, you know, it's a pretty cool thing to do. And also you could, you know, switch out, for instance, environment. So we did it now for the European diet and the metabolites that get kind of whatever ends up in the large intestine. But you could also ask the question, what happens in, you know, that that experimental lab medium, the M9 medium, and you could rerun the analysis with that and see, do you actually see that separation in the same growth medium, or is it kind of specific to the particular environmental condition provided by the human gut? That would be interesting as well. And maybe looking a little bit into that, into niche variability, that's actually, you know, visually we do see those separations, right? But let's also put some hard numbers on that. And that's what we will have you do in the exercise. So we talked about that yesterday, but we have those distances between different growth niches. And one thing we could ask about is, you know, is that distance matrix actually dictated by a particular, you know, additional information? Is there a significant association in that separation? And for instance, the phylogeny, like, you know, it looks from that first map that we did that there is, right? Like different genera seem to separate quite well and they form those clusters of assemblies of the same genus, but, you know, we want to actually get maybe a statistical test on that. And we learned yesterday that a good test for that is PERMANOVA, which is a permuted analysis of variants. And it actually basically does that. So it takes a distance matrix, it takes some, you know, additional data for the organisms that we have in that distance matrix, and then it kind of tells you if there's like a significant separation kind of present in that distance matrix based on that covariate. And we looked yesterday, if you kind of want to learn more about how that actually works and how PERMANOVA works, you can do that by looking at the materials from yesterday. But yeah, essentially it will tell you how much of the variation in the inter-assembly or inter-strain distances is explained by particular covariates. And the covariates that we will be looking at is, for instance, the taxonomic ranks. Like, for instance, does the genus, how much variation in the differences and uptake preferences is explained by the genus, for instance, or by the species. And that's what you will look at. The first example runs it for the genus. The first thing we need to do is actually convert in an actual distance matrix. We only looked at the actual profiles and they were kind of generated like opaquely in the UMAP production, but here we will actually generate them again. We use like the parallel distance function from SciPy, and then we convert it to a distance matrix with scikit-bio. Funnily enough, that kind of the code that we're running here is actually the same code that runs the PERMANOVA and CHIME2 as well. So if you were wondering, you know, where does CHIME2 get it from? That's kind of what they do. You use that scikit-bio package here, which has a PERMANOVA function. So it's the first step, you create that distance matrix, which will be fairly large. If that, you know, runs really long, you can actually stop it and just don't do the final print, which is what, for instance, you can only have it output the shape and rerun it, and it would actually run much faster because it mostly runs on showing the distance matrix here. So maybe we'll change that. So we see we get a distance matrix 979. That's because we had 979 strains or assemblies in that particular data set. So now that matrix kind of has the distance from each strain to each other strain. So it kind of tells you how far they're away from each other strain in their uptake preferences. And we can run the PERMANOVA and we run it on the genus. So we basically say, you know, use our isolates and then run it on the genus level using the distances that we just calculated. And we'll kind of see if those distances are kind of explained by the genus in a fairly well. And we add in the R squared, which is the fraction of explained variance with the helper function. That will take about a minute and it will tell us basically, you know, is there a significant separation in the inter-strain uptake preferences based on the genus only. And it will also tell us exactly how much of the variation in those uptake preferences are kind of explained by the genus. This is not based on a projection. It doesn't really use a map for that. It actually takes, you know, the full dimensional distance matrix. So yeah, it works. It's a bit like more detailed than what we actually see on that map projection. And because it might've been an artifact of the UMAP algorithm, right? Maybe the UMAP algorithm made clusters look farther away than they actually are, because it's always hard to represent those information two dimensions. And we get that summary. You know, we see we had a sample size of 979. There were 32, there's actually 33 different genera. The number of groups usually have like one reference group and then the rest is different to the reference group. You get a test statistic, which is kind of the F value, which is hard to interpret. That's why we ended it as R squared. So here what we get is that 71% of the variation in uptake rates is explained by the genus, which is, you know, pretty big fraction. So we probably do have phylogenetic niche conservatism going on to a certain degree. Like, you know, the majority of those inter-strain differences are definitely, you know, explained by the genus, but you will also run it for the species. And one thing to ask is, if you add in the species, does that jump to 100%? Is it like all explained by different species? Or is there like some variation that is left and that's not even explained by the species that happens on the strain level? And that's what you will do in the exercise. Yeah, and we will, you know, what did happen to the R squared? Like, does it explain less or more? If you actually do it on the species level, try to argument what you would expect and why. How do they compare to each other? And, you know, what happens with the unexplained variants? So in this case right now, about 29% of the variance is not explained by the genus. It's explained by other factors. And that would be like one question to answer here as well. And yeah, with that, we are done for today. So I hope that was kind of useful to you and gave you an impression, like, you know, how you can use metabolic modeling to get a little bit of, you know, predict at least a little bit what the ecology of those organisms could look like. It's definitely, you know, helpful to have that metabolic model at hand where you initially started out with the genome, but now you actually predicted the behavior of the organism in a particular environment. You saw which molecules it uses to build up biomass. You can even, you know, alter that organism and simulate it. You could switch out environments, see how it actually changes the uptake preferences of that organism. You could compared to other organisms and see if there's predicted competition going on, if there's compatibility in niches where basically there's very little niche overlap. So you would expect those organisms to be able to function well in the same environment. That's all like insights you can at least predict. And you did that basically just on a genome assembly. There wasn't really any other data we gave you. The only additional data you used is a formulation of the environment, which was kind of the composition that we had from the dietary data that we mapped into fluxes. But you didn't really have any prior information how that organism would interact with that particular environment. That was all inferred by the metabolic model. So I hope that's useful to you. Like I said, if you're interested in going maybe a step further and looking at how to combine those models into larger full microbial community models, where you can also directly model the metabolic interactions between different taxa, you could look at the videos from last year's course, or everything is still online, including the notebooks. So you can use that information as well. And yeah, we'll be happy to hear all your questions. And there's still a lot of really cool program going on for today. So now where we kind of learned about metabolic modeling, one thing we didn't talk about at all, we kind of, you know, left out, is that we talked about isolates from the human gut microbiome, but we didn't really talk about what would be the impact of those bacteria on us as humans, right? So we are intimately connected with our gut microbes. Like, a lot of what we eat actually passes through the gut microbiome, and they will provide metabolites that also get taken up by us as hosts and end up in our bloodstream. And a lot of that, you know, might alter maybe the physiological function of our own body. And Priyanka will give like an awesome example for that and how that might actually interact with our own host, with our own body, or we as hosts for the microbiome. And we will see like a good example of that. And that will happen right after a break that we'll be taking. We have a little bit more time now. So let's just reiterate maybe our project challenge as well. So as you have seen yesterday in the Slack channel, we gave you a chance to also win like some ISB branded t-shirts that we will be sending out to you if you participate in the project challenge and get chosen as one of the, you know, highlighted projects there. And basically how that works is that was based on yesterday's course. So if you want to participate, you haven't participated in yesterday's course, you might want to work through that as well and kind of see what happened in CHIME 2. Maybe you already know CHIME 2 and you're very invited to participate in that case as well. And the challenge was to kind of use the data set from yesterday, which were different microbial composition from different environments from the Earth Microbiome Project, and use only CHIME 2 and the included visualizations and analysis steps to kind of create a figure based on that particular data set from last day's course and a caption for it. And we will actually award that based on geographical regions. So, you know, there's more than one chance to win. There's not only one single person who will receive a t-shirt. We will pick like winning projects from each geographical region. And yeah, the only thing you need to do is create a figure and a caption with Chime 2 and submit that on the Slack challenge channel. So yeah, if you still want to participate, also feel free to do that. And with that, I think we can kind of stop this session of the course. Like I said, there's a lot of cool stuff still coming. Our presentation by Priyanka Baloni will be amazing, and that will be following right up here. Then we will have another break and we come to the closing remarks. And then we will have some time to maybe work on the project challenge. And tomorrow we'll be continuing with an awesome symposium. So, and that will actually connect with a few things that we have seen today as well. So everything kind of works in unison. So thanks too much. And also, again, thanks so much for the ISB team that made all of this possible. It's really not, if you look at the video, you might think it's like a one person job here, but it could not be further from the truth. Even right now I'm looking at all our TAs, in a very large socially distant space here, and which are super active on Slack answering questions. And it wouldn't be possible without all the organizational team. There's so much going on here. And yeah, I hope it was helpful to you, and we'll see each other tomorrow for the symposium. And yeah, I wish you a great day. An awesome talk with Priyanka. And we'll be hearing a little bit more from our sponsors in the break as well. So stay tuned for that. And thanks, everybody.